G'day guys, in this video I'll look at noise in Blender animations and how it can be mitigated. All noise stems from random sampling in the cycle's path tracing engine. At low sample rates, the noise shows as speckles. With enough samples, eventually a perfectly clean image will be created, but that can take a long time. The denoisers built into Blender perform spatial denoising, so you don't have to wait forever. Spatial denoisers smooth out the differences between neighboring pixels. They do an amazing job to clean up noise while still retaining details. A seemingly perfect denoised image can exhibit artifacts like flickering and shimmering when used in an animation. Sometimes spatial denoising exacerbates the problems in video. This type of video noise is called temporal noise and stems from the differences between consecutive frames. It requires a different type of denoiser strategy to fix the problem. Spatial denoising only operates in XY dimensions. Temporal denoising operates in the time dimension. Temporal denoisers and spatial denoisers work together to reduce noise in animations. Blender can perform temporal denoising using NVidia OptiX, though, as of Blender 3.5, it is still hidden under the developer extras. The hardware-based AI denoiser is designed for ray trace games, where it has to operate with a budget of 1 to 2 ray trace samples per pixel. It's designed to be temporally stable, even with extreme noise. It is also possible to perform temporal denoising with some node magic in the compositor. I've created a temporal denoising node group to figure out how it works, identify limitations and problems, and compare the results with OptiX. The key mechanism to reduce noise is to render more samples, but who has GPU time to burn? When you double the number of samples, you don't get double the quality. There's a diminishing return. One way you can get extra free samples is by merging consecutive frames. In this example, merging 3 frames of 1024 samples has a similar noise level as a single frame rendered with 3072 samples. The image is not noise-free, but spatial denoising will give a better result. Importantly, since you're merging consecutive frames, it will help smooth out the interframe differences that cause flickering. This simplistic example fails and causes ghosting wherever there is movement in the image. However, Blender provides a mechanism to compensate for movement between frames. The cycle's vector render layer outputs motion vectors, which describe how objects move between frames. It gives the XY motion for each pixel in the image. The RGBA data actually gives you 2 vectors, one to the previous frame and one from the next frame. My temporal denoising node groups can be used to visualize the motion vectors, which I'll demonstrate using this test scene. Load your EXR image sequence in the compositor, then duplicate and give each a separate frame offset. This gives you access to the previous, current, and next frames. The temporal denoising node group has inputs for the image and motion vector from the 3 consecutive frames. I'll use the debug node group to show the motion vectors. The vectors are visualized using colors, where hue represents the direction of motion and luminosity the distance. Focusing on the cube, the motion vector either points down or to the right. The direction is not flipped when comparing the forward and reverse vectors. The displaced node transforms the neighboring frames using motion vectors, but there are problems. The objects are displaced, but there's also a ghost copy of the objects in the original position. Furthermore, shadows are not displaced and remain at the original position too. The image displacement is performed at every pixel of the image. The motion vector at the new position displaces the first frame to the same position as the second. But there is also a motion vector of 0, 0 at the position where the background is revealed. This displaces the image into the same position, creating the ghost objects. The motion vector causing the ghost image is simply the vector for the background object. In this case, the background is not moving, hence the zero vector. The motion vector is technically valid, even when an object is hidden or off-screen in the neighbouring frame, although technically valid doesn't mean much when it causes ghosting. As expected, when you do a simple mix of the three images, the ghosted objects are shown with lower opacity. All shadows are partially transparent too. Instead, smarter frame blending is required that will eliminate the ghosting and correct the shadows. Consider this baseball moving across a brick wall. The green arrows indicate the forward motion vector for both objects. Likewise, the reverse motion vector indicates the pixel position in the previous frame. There's a correlation between the two vectors in neighbouring frames. Adding the reverse vector from the current frame plus the forward vector from the previous frame will get you back to your starting point. Well, except when it doesn't. Consider this patch of the brick wall. The reverse motion vector points to the right. But in the previous frame, the baseball was present at that location. The forward vector at this position points further to the right and not back to the starting point. When the forward and reverse vectors are not opposite, it's an area of the scene where the frames don't match, which is where the displace node would create ghost images. By comparing motion vectors, the node group will generate a mask of areas to include or exclude from blending. But it doesn't solve the shadow problem. This example still requires a tight threshold for luminosity to prevent blending shadow and non-shadow areas. A solution would be rendering and compositing shadows separately, since temporal denoising could be performed prior to overlaying the shadows. As far as I can tell, the shadow catcher pass cannot do what I need. The shadow catcher can only operate with specific objects, whereas I need to automatically capture all shadows, irrespective of what object they hit. For a proof of concept, I did a test render where I duplicated the scene and disabled shadow ray visibility for every object. Note that illumination will be affected, but for my scene, the difference was minimal. With the two sets of renders, I could use Divide to isolate the shadows. Then, after temporal denoising, multiply the shadows back in. It worked well. Thresholds were no longer required to handle shadows. Of course, this workflow is not practical, because the scene must be rendered twice. It would be great if Blender could automatically output all shadows in a separate render layer. Let's compare node-based temporal denoising with OptiX. These scenes were rendered with a low sample count, so strong temporal noise is evident. OptiX appears to remove more temporal noise in the monster scene. However, the node-based denoiser retains more detail. For the junk shop scene, I think the node-based temporal denoiser might have the edge over OptiX. Most noticeable to me are the arrow on the gauge and then her face and hair. Again, both do a good job of cleaning up the temporal noise and would do even better with a high number of samples. The temporal denoising process is a bit quirky and prone to inaccuracies, but it works. Given our reliance on spatial denoising, most animations will require some level of temporal denoising. Render your animation as a multi-layer EXR and include the required render passes. you then have the option of using OptiX or node-based temporal denoising, or simply rendering additional samples where required. Node-based temporal denoising is a bit slower than OptiX and does require some effort to configure. At least there is scope to tweak the process to get the most out of your animation. Download my node group for free. The link is in the video description. Anyway, thanks for watching. I hope you have found this helpful. Please like and subscribe. I appreciate any questions or comments and look forward to any suggestions for improving the node group.